Welcome back, Doc Stools. I'm Tom. So I've saved up a big batch of meatloaf for you guys. I know you guys, you really like these meatloaf episodes. So no machining and no tool making stuff in this, but we got some really interesting stuff to look at and check out the pile. And then we have some updates on some of the things from the last meatloaf and just kind of a mixed bag of really neat stuff. So let's go check it out. First off, I want to give you guys a little sneak preview of some upcoming videos. And you guys have been watching some of the lapping stuff that I've been doing. These are some that are kind of in an intermediate stage here. We're going to go through and we're going to show how to make cast iron laps and then some very special copper laps for doing the finish work. So that's going to be an upcoming couple of videos. So there seems to be a kind of a positive response to these lapping videos. So we're gonna extend with that and do some more. So stay tuned for that and get ready. You know, you'll be able to make your own laps in your own shop, and you don't need super fancy measuring tools, so that'll be good. This first one is a recent group of flea market finds, and there's kind of some interesting pieces in here. We'll just kind of go through it quickly. Kind of the highlights here are these curved Nicholson files, and these are called body files, BODIFILE. It's a 50-210. I didn't even know Nicholson made these. Okay, well, a guy had a whole pile of them there, and so I bought two of them, and $8 a piece, so it was a nice price. And I tried it out, and boy, these things cut like the dickens. So they're kind of neat, you know, for doing curved surfaces and whatnot. So that was one find. This is a rusty pair of Brown and Sharp calipers, and their tips are a little different than the Sterrett's, and that's kind of what sets them apart. These are just friction joint ones, and you'll see these will clean up nicely. This is just a really light coating of rust on them, so these will clean up really nicely. So that's nice find. I think those were $2 or $3 for those. So, you know, it's like, gee, I can't leave it laying. Now, this one's kind of interesting here. This is a, what I believe this is, and some of those iron workers out there can correct me if I got this wrong. So it's a drift for aligning holes in bolt holes and flanges and gussets and stuff like that. But it has a little kink in it, so you can jam it in there, and if you're wiggling it around from the other end, this won't fall through. Or you can just stab it in there and you don't have to hold it, and you can do something else and put a fastener in or whatnot. So anyway, it's just a good lineup drift, and that was a couple bucks. I don't have one like that. This is a flange separating wedge. So when you're breaking two flanges apart, there's typically a little gap because they're raised faces, and you can usually get these in between and knock them in there, and helps spread them apart so you can replace gaskets and stuff like that. I almost always buy wedges if they're cheap, just because they're a pain to make, and they're really handy when you have them around. A shop-made machinist scraper. Okay, this is made out of a three-cornered file that they must have had to reach in somewhere because it's pretty long, and it's actually nicely sharpened. And this is, you know, that was a couple bucks, so I said, "What the heck? I'll get it right." And now these guys here, these are square sockets, so they fit it isn't really square, but they fit a square or they're 8-point, okay? And, you know, I have a set of these, and I found them to be very, very handy around the shop and for all kinds of oddball uses. You can drive taps with them, the little studs on the Greenlee punches. There's all kinds of things that you can use them for. So whenever I see them, I just kind of I kind of snap them up and throw them in the box, you know, and there's that. This is a an old strapping tensioner here. So the two straps go through here, and then you can tension and then put the clip on, and then you can release with this. So it's made by Signode, which is a, you know, they make banding equipment and things like that. So pretty cool. A couple bucks for that. Or actually, this was more. This is like 10 bucks or something like that. And the last thing here, this is a 3M, and it's colored tape in a little dispenser. And these things are shockingly expensive. I don't know why they're so damn expensive, but this is kind of nice for marking wires or color coding wires and stuff like that. So this, you know, electrician stuff. Okay, so that was a Sunday flea market find, and it was a really nice day, and we had a nice lunch afterwards. So and found some neat goodies. This was part of the flea market tools find, and a guy had a couple of books. These are a buck a piece. Okay, let's look at this one first here. For folks looking kind of for a general text on machining operations from sawing all the way to basic CNCs and EDM stuff. This is actually a pretty good book. I have a copy of this in my library, but for a dollar I bought it, and I figured I'd just pass it along to somebody. Let's see, I don't remember what the date is on this guy here. There's the ISBN number if you guys are hunting it down, okay? I'll hold still for a second. So yeah, this is, I'm trying to, 1979? Yeah, so, you know, it's not totally current, but, you know, a lot of this stuff doesn't change, right? And they've got indexing, sine bar operations, surface grinder, heat treating. Oh, that I flagged that picture because there's a big planer mill in there. That was kind of a neat picture. So it's got the theory and kind of setup stuff. So good text for kind of to keep around if you're just getting into this work and or, you know, looking to bone up on some stuff. This other one here, and once again, I have this also, and I just love this book. This guy, oh, excuse me. All right. Anyway, this guy was an artist, and he took up blacks. I guess he moved to this, I don't know, somewhere Southeast Asia or whatever, and they took up blacksmithing and tool making, right? These kinds of tools. But what I like about this particular book is the illustrations. Let's see if we can. He's got these shaded pencil drawings or pen and ink drawings of these different operations and different tools that are just wonderful. And, you know, that's one of the neat things about this book is it's, you know, there's some artwork in it, and it's cool. It's not pictures, but it's they're excellent diagrams and hand sketches of some of these tool-making operations. So anyway, just kind of a neat book if you're into blacksmithing or you want to make tools. It's the Making of Tools, Alexander Wingers. Yeah, look at that. Look at this great picture here. It's just a very nice picture, okay? So anyway, this was a buck at the flea market. All right, so this next lot, this comes to us from a friend of mine in Batavia, Illinois, Mike Henry, and he sent me an email and said, hey, listen, I'm getting ready to get rid of some books out of my library that he has duplicates of, or he just wanted to clear out. So he sent me a list, and I said, oh boy, there's a couple titles in there I wouldn't mind having. And anyway, so a big box showed up, and here we are. Now, you know, I'm not going to dig through each one of these, but there's some interesting items in here that we should talk about. This is an old, and these used to come out regularly, machinery series, and they're on very specific narrow subjects. And they're kind of interesting because they got good information in them, and you can see them or you can pick them up reasonably cheap, but they're a very narrow focus, I guess, is what I'm trying to get to. So there's one on, here's one on drop forging, and here's one on bearings and couplings and bearings again and springs and things like that. So, you know, you can find, you can just kind of pick and choose the subject matter for, instead of a general text, it's a more specific text. So that's kind of nice about that. So keep your eyes peeled for those. Those are kind of neat to find. This is a machine tool primer. I don't have any marks in this one. I flipped through it, and it's just got some neat drawings. You know, it's kind of a general text on machine tool operations, things like that. And you know, I kind of collect these, and you know, I usually find one or two good little nuggets in each one, something that somebody doesn't have in one of the other ones. So just kind of an interesting one. But yeah, I didn't put any flags in that one. I guess I didn't see anything. This is a machine shop training course. Okay, got a couple flags in there, and I think these are on this kind of items on lapping, which I've been studying myself a little bit. So they're exploring myself, I should say. So this is kind of a there's a name in there, somebody's name, right? They're everywhere. A general text on and training course. So I think, I don't know how many volumes there are. Fifth edition, volume one. I wonder how many volumes there are. I don't know. What's this one here? Oh, so once again, I'm always interested in things that are kind of self-proving. And so there's a method for lapping straight edges together to get them a true straight surface, right? So you need to make three. I kind of like the three plate method, you know, one to two, two to three, three to two, you know, et cetera. And then you can actually generate a very straight straight surface, okay? Just like you can create a flat surface. Anyway, those are good books. I only marked a couple of spots in those. So, Brown & Sharpe catalog, older Brown & Sharpe catalog. These are kind of neat. You can find you can find all those tools that you don't have that now you suddenly need. So so these are a little bit dangerous to have, you know, but it does help you with the nomenclature, you know, what they call things, and you know, actual model numbers, you know, of different things. Let's see. And this one, so this is part of a whole nother story here, and I think that's in this book coming up here. Handbook of Practical Mechanics. Hey, it's by Saunders. John? No. I think this is older than John, so, this was kind of cool. So some little girl had cut these out of a magazine and was playing around with paper dolls, and these are... well, you know, you can look at the clothes. I mean, these are 20s or 30s or something like that kind of outfits. But they were snipped out of a magazine, and some little kid was playing with them. So anyway, it was in the book, right? You never know what you're going to find in these books. I didn't flag anything in here. This is another general text. This cam layouts. Interesting, there was some kind of handwritten charts in here. I just saw one, but I won't be able to get back to it. But, you know, look at the book cover, right? I mean, it's just kind of neat how they did that, right? Ooh, her foot sticking out. I better push that up in there. Anyway, it's just kind of a nice cover on that. So, this is a pretty common book. You know, once again, a general text for student machinists, you know, how to do different stuff. And this is a good little book to add to your collection. This is, you know, it's pretty easy to come by. In fact, I think Sterrett still sells this or gives it away if you write them a letter or something. So this guy's been around, he's long gone, but he's an old name in machine work. He's written quite a few different books, so if you search his name, you'll find a lot of different books on machine tool stuff. So, once again, yet another book. So the stuff you get out of books like this is is kind of weird setups, different kinds of work holding items, okay? You know, some different tricks for holding different kinds of items. So, you know, this is why I collect these kinds of books is, you know, there's always something to learn from history, right? And so if you do a, you know, do a little historical research yourself by reading or looking at old texts and whatnot, you can glean some knowledge that may be applicable, you know, to modern work. So just some kind of neat stuff. So, okay, Fred Colvin, that's a name to remember there. Okay, so this one here, we're not going to dig into it, but I want you to look at this. Now, this came from an antique store in Petaluma, okay? And, you know, it's handmade, so somebody sawed this out and then filed it, and you know, it's a good little, it's a good little hand vise, right? So let's see if I can find this in here. It's gonna, there it is, right there. So take a look at that. There it is. I mean, almost down to the little nipple on the end. You know, tapered polygon here. It's even got. You see these little, these kind of little decorative ticks in it here. Okay, so I'm wondering if this was a. It might have been some kind of shop project or something like that that. That folks did. Anyway, this was a couple of bucks at an antique store, and I picked it up recently. And this is a pure coincidence here that I saw this in this book, but just kind of neat, right? And I don't know, what else we got in this one here? Oh, that's pretty cool. So somebody, they made a chisel, and they drove it through a 2.5-inch thick block of steel. Now, I almost want to try that just for fun, but that seems like a lot of hammering to me, but that's pretty damn amazing if you ask me. So somebody would even try that. All right. And this is grinding wheels and machines. Okay. I got more review in here. I want to look at it some more. So lathe works for beginners. Mark something. Oh, that's kind of neat. So there's a an attachment for a micrometer to read tenths directly. So they've added a hub on there where it divides each thousandths of an inch into 10 parts so that you can actually read direct to and not use a vernier to read tenths. So kind of neat. It just caught my attention. Never seen anything like that, but it's something you could build to add to a regular micrometer, which might be kind of neat. Okay, and then this is pretty cool. It's an apprenticeship book from the Brown and Sharp Company, and it's got some paperwork in it from and a letter from somebody that met with the folks at Brown and Sharp, which is kind of neat. And we'll probably show a little bit more on this. This is something that's important to me about, you know, young people learning the trade. And this is embossed. It's just a really nice little handout here. Okay. And then the last one is South Bend machining course. Okay. So this has got projects in it, which is kind of neat. Different stuff, screwdrivers, you can make a bolt, dead center, or two dead centers. Plumb bob, and it's got all the kind of orders of operations and whatnot. So this would be a good kind of a project book, and I've actually marked it to scan, so that might be a good thing to throw up and for people that are looking for projects to do. Okay, hey Mike, thanks for sending this stuff in. This is great, great addition to my library, and we'll be seeing more of this. Okay, so this next one here, this was sent in by a viewer in Poway, California. Alonzo Clark sent me this, and he thought I would enjoy this tool, and I do. It's very old, It's a Dietzen protractor, and they didn't even, this is how old it is, they didn't even spell it all out. And then you can look at you can look at the font here too. It's a very kind of an old font. And this is a draftsman's protractor here. This is not really a shop tool. This would be used in the office for doing drafting work and whatnot. And you got to love this little centering icon there, which is kind of neat, right? It's very that's very old school, where they would have this flourish like this to indicate the center of the arc. So, Alonzo, thanks for sending that in. That's kind of a neat tool, and I'll put it with my other drafting instruments. Thank you, sir. All right, we got a little update on this picture here. So, some sharp-eyed viewers out there, I believe, correctly identified the lathe as a Bradford lathe. Now, interestingly, this is an English lathe, so this was imported from England, made in England, and it's got some of the characteristics that we noted in the first video of the way the lead screw's mounted, and then you see the apron has a sharp corner on it here. That has a sharp corner. This appears to be a slightly different model. This has a quick change gearbox, where we're pretty sure this one has change gears here. Anyway, and the tailstock looks very similar as well. Anyway, that was good. Some viewers pointed that out. And some other guys actually noted that, let's make sure this is still in the picture here, that the Hart Parr Tractor Company is in Charles City, Iowa, or was in Charles City, Iowa. And that's where there's a little watermark on here from the photographer that says Charles City, Iowa. And if you look in the background here, this looks to be valves or pistons or something like that. So somebody speculated that this possibly was from the Hart Parr Tractor Company, which is pretty cool, right? I mean, you know, the power of the viewership out there participating in this, you know, with their particular knowledge, we can bring it all together kind of in one place, which is kind of neat. Now, we don't know this for sure, so this is speculation, so, but it's just kind of fun to think about. And then the last thing was, you know, and I haven't done so much cast iron that I've ever had my apron look like that, but Robin Renzetti said, listen, I've done enough cast iron that it gets in your apron and your clothes, and it just looks like grease. There's just so much dust in your clothing, so this guy's definitely probably doing cast iron, and he's well covered up. He's got dirt on his face even. So anyway, Bradford lathe and possibly the Hart Parr Tractor Company. Very cool. All right, there's a little update on our colleague Florence Bloom, and this was her machinery's handbook. And we talked about her in Meatloaf 110, and she worked at the Lockheed Skunk Works. And a couple of viewers contacted me, and one of them is an ex Air Force pilot, and he mentioned that he had to interact with engineers at Lockheed on the flight performance of certain planes. Anyway, he thinks he may have met her at some point. The other interesting email I got was a link to a newspaper article from 1960 or 61, something like that. And it mentioned Florence Bloom working for Lockheed, and she was working on the Polaris missile program, okay, which is actually an interesting missile. It's one of the first submarine-launched ICBM. And it had some very, very unique engineering challenges, in particular associated with guidance and whatnot. And then an acquaintance, his dad worked on some component that actually initiates the rocket as it breaks the surface of the water. So it's punched out with air, I believe, and then the rocket ignites just as it gets out of the water, and off it goes. So anyway, a little update on Florence Bloom, who was an aeronautical engineer at the Lockheed Company working in the Skunk Works. So thanks, Florence, and we're going to remember you. All right, so there's also an update of our colleague here, Louis Fasulo, and this was his book, and this is the Henry Ford Shop Theory book. Anyway, this is just a wonderful conclusion to this, or addition to this story. So Louis, just to remind folks, Louis worked at Los Alamos on the Manhattan Project, along with some esteemed folks like Fermi and Feynman. Anyway, he was a machinist there in Shop C, which was the big, large machine shop there. I've since learned that that was what was going on there. And then he, whoops, let me flip that over. Then he moved to Colorado and worked at Rocky Flats. And I misidentified Rocky Flats as in Idaho. I was, there's Idaho National Lab, and then there's Rocky Flats, which is a, I actually make bomb components there. Anyway, Louis worked at Rocky Flats in Colorado. He's since died. He died in 2015. Now, what's interesting about the rest of this story is a viewer, one of my viewers, who lives in Colorado, watched the video, and he recognized Lewis's name, and his name is Scott Lange, and he lives in Arvada, Colorado, and he went to an estate sale, and he bought Louis Fasulo's tools. So this is just a wonderful circular story here where Louis had the tools first, he used them for his career, retired, then died, and then ultimately Scott ended up with his tools, and Scott is a tool and die maker, and he uses those tools every day. And I got some pictures, so let's check out some pictures. And then you can see there's a hand scraped surface plate in there. There's actually some tools that are identified as from Los Alamos. It's just a wonderful, like I said, a circular, you know, completion of this, of Lewis's story. And you know, Lewis is in the big shop in the sky, and Scott has his tools, and perhaps, you know, Scott's son or grandson or whatever will end up with those tools as well. So this goes back to, you know, what I've said about, you know, the story behind the people and the tools that they use. So it's there's just a lot of history there that we can capture. And then this just shows the, you know, the power of the internet and the ability to communicate over large distances and bring a lot of people together that have a common interest. So pretty cool. Thank you, Louis. I appreciate it. Scott, thank you so much for sending the pictures of the tools and helping us complete this story. All right, so I showed this Pratt & Whitney Toolmakers flat in Meatloaf 110. And this is basically a round, gigantic gauge block is what this is. It's flat enough to that gauge blocks will ring to it. Now, I actually found it in Pratt & Whitney gauge catalog, and let's find it there. And there it is right there. So, I forgot to reread it before that. So, so flats are lap flat and parallel within 10 millionths or something like that. And gauges will ring to them, and they are of special alloy steel, yada, yada, yada. Pretty neat. Now, I don't have a price list for this particular Pratt & Whitney catalog, and this was a number 12. So I'm not sure. Well, let's see. Let's look at the date here. Maybe we can, where is the date here? Okay, this is 1954, so if anybody's got a Pratt & Whitney price list from 54. That'd be kind of interesting to see what those kind of go for. Anyway, this is kind of neat, but this dovetails in with another thing is a friend of mine came over. You know, we've been talking about the history of tools and the people that owned them and our connection to the past through these tools. And he dropped off this right here. You know, he saw that story and he thought it was great. And so look at that. It's another one. But it's not a Pratt & Whitney. This is, somebody made this. Okay, and you know, he said it was cast iron, but I don't think it's cast iron. I think it's hard steel because I touched the edge with a file and it's pretty darn hard. But here's the neat part here. Look at that. I hope you can see that. It says GRC 1905. So some guy stamped his name in there in 1905. And, you know, I think he was probably making one of those is what he was doing. And now I haven't checked to see how flat this one is and how parallel it is. It's got a surface grind and then a kind of a light lap on it, but it's got some dings in it. So what we may do as part of our lapping exercises is go ahead and relap this too, so which will be fun on our new large laps. So anyway, this is from my friend Andy Buchanan, a VPI machine. Andy, thanks for bringing that by. And this was some guy that was in Maryland. We don't know anything about him, but when Andy was a kid, this was in their shop, and he remembers seeing it there when he was just a young boy. And he's been a machinist his whole life, and he's in his 60s now. So this has been around for quite a while. Anyway, kind of a neat tie together of a story there. All right, so this next one is pretty cool. This is from my friend Andy Buchanan at VPI Machine. He's here in Benicia, and he came by for a visit and he brought some stuff with him, and this thing is actually pretty cool. What it is it's a big sine bar, all right? It's a, you can see the rule there and the pivot there. It's 20 inches, okay? So it's a pretty good sized sine bar. But what's really neat about it is its history. So this came from Mare Island Naval Shipyard. It doesn't have any maker's marks on it, but it's all hand scraped. So this was all hand scraped, the base, the top, it's and everything, and these guys out there made it. It's a fixture for something, you know, some kind of submarine thing, okay? But what I really want to show you, the kind of the highlight of this thing is some of the attention to detail at this end here. This is a locking mechanism that's noteworthy, and we'll take a look at this. But let's open it up all the way to start with, okay? And you can kind of see it, and you can see the scraping where they scraped it in, okay, and I had a penny between the roll and the base here, okay, and we can kind of see this. It's on a little cam, okay, and we'll show you how that works in just a second, okay. Let's flip it over. So these guys did the castings, okay. So this is a casting that they had for something, or they actually cast it in particular for this item. I don't know. Like I said, there's no maker marks on it. So that's a big booger. Let's take a closer look at this very cool mechanism here. Okay, so what we have here, let's take the top off and you can kind of see. So it's got a rod, but it's got this little kind of collet assembly here. And this has a female taper on the inside. So we can raise and lower the sine bar, okay? And then put our blocks underneath. Actually, let's put a block underneath there. make some sense, okay? And then what we can do is lock this collet down like so, and then I'll cinch that down, okay? And then it's got this cam arrangement here that I'm tweaking down. So what it's doing is it's pulling it down on top of my block, right? And see, my block is nice and secure in there. So this is a, you know, kind of a dilemma with lots of sign bars, is some of them don't have a good provision for locking it. Anyway, this is just kind of an elegant solution, I thought. Some guy machined all this. This little handle is made out of one piece here. So he made a, you know, he turned this, it's got a taper on it, and then it's got a ball on one end, and you know, some handwork, and it's just nicely done. And then, like I said, the attention to detail, let me spin this around. So, it's even got, where'd it go? Oh, maybe it's the other end here. Oh, sorry. Let me slide down here. The pivot end, look, they even got little oilers. They got little ball oilers in it and stuff. It's just really nicely made. Anyway, Andy, thank you very much for sending that. That's kind of a cool tool. And you know, that's 20-inch sign bar. I can't say that a lot of shops have a 20-inch sign bar. So thank you, sir. Okay, so this next one, this is a follow-on to the Polariscope. And this was sent to me by Len Chodaker, and he's in up in Canada, and he's a glass worker, and he does glass sculpture. And he's the guy, just to remind you, he sent me the glass ball peen hammer, which is pretty cool. And he sent me this little Polariscope here that's just made out of polarizing film and a flashlight with a diffuser. Well, not to be outdone, my friend John Marcus down at PTC Instruments in Los Angeles, apparently, and I didn't know this, his company makes a 6-inch Polariscope. And this is a pretty fancy unit here, actually. So this box shows up, and I'm like, what the heck's in here, right? So I open it up, and ta-da, there it is, right? So we're gonna shoot down through the top of this thing and shoot some images and take a look at some of these different pieces I have here through this PTC Instruments Polariscope, which is pretty cool. Let's check it out. Okay, so we got this thing turned on. I had to turn the shop lights out. So let's put this fork in there. Okay. This is just a molded plastic fork, and you can already see the fringes there. And then this one has what he calls a tint plate. And if I rotate, not that way, dopey. If I rotate the tint plate, it goes through a series of color changes. Oh, actually, that one's pretty good there. I like that one. Okay. And then, so here's how this thing is used. You're seeing stress concentrations there. And then I'll go ahead and flex this a little bit. You can watch those stress concentrations move around, okay? So light comes through this, and it intersects areas that have different refractive indices. And the light is... it's actually fairly complicated to understand, and I barely understand it myself, but the light is retarded as it passes through these different refractive indices, okay? So it's slowed down and it comes out in a slightly different direction, okay? And that's kind of how this works. So it's, if you want to do a little more reading on it, there's a link in the description on photoelasticity that gets into the theory of this and how it works. But it's pretty cool. So let's rotate the tint plate again, okay? And you can see the main light's coming through. Now we blocked most of it off. Actually, that's pretty good right there. So let's look at something else here. I got these safety glasses, which is kind of... Actually, you know what? Let me raise this one up a little bit. Raise that one up a little bit. I hope that doesn't take it out of focus there. Okay. All right. So there's a pair of safety glasses. Let's rotate the tint plate again. All
right. That looks pretty good. That's yerp, yerp.
Okay.
So that's pretty neat. So, you know, so I think people that do plastic molding and stuff like that use these to do, you know, analysis on molded parts like this, right? To see if things are changing or if the if it's too, the plastic coming in is too hot. I mean, there's all kinds of things, I guess, that you can learn from this. Although I've never used one myself in industry to do any analysis. So yeah, it's pretty neat. Okay, let's look at one of these glass pieces here. Okay. So I think this one's fairly stressed out here. All right, you can see the, all right, let's rotate the tent plate again. You can see. And then what's neat about this one here is too, that we can just kind of go black and white on this one by rotating the tent plate out of the way, right? And I think this is, what is it? That's the analyzer. Yeah, so the analyzer kind of gives us the same thing. All right, it's a little tiger stripe. So you can see the, kind of in black and white, the, let's see if we can get this one to change here. Yep, so you see them moving a little bit as I put a little load on this. I don't want to break this. I wonder what blood looks like under the Polariscope. Anyway, John, thank you very much. That is a really neat toy. And I appreciate you sending that in. And, you know, thanks for the nice surprise. And Len, thank you very much for sending out the cool hammer and getting this whole ball rolling here so we can all learn about Polariscopes and photoelasticity.
All right, so this is a new addition to Tom's metrology equipment. You know, I've been kind of, ever since I had Standridge Granite come in and calibrate my my granite surface plates here, I've been wanting to have an autocollimator. And so I've been stalking around on eBay, kind of waiting for one to pop up at the right kind of price. Anyway, I managed to get this one, and it was a good buy. It was about 300 bucks, I think, somewhere in that region, plus some shipping. And it's an old Navy one. I love the tag that's on it too. Now, this is very similar to the one that they use to calibrate my surface plates. So it has a light source here, and the way it works is autocollimators, they actually measure very, very tiny angular changes, okay? And so what it does, and let me shift this down just a whisker here, all right? So we're gonna pretend that this is a reflecting surface here. Let's double check, make sure you guys can see that in the picture. All right, I'll scoot it down a little more, okay? Scoot it down a little more. So we're going to pretend that this is a mirror here on this end. So what it does is we send light. I got to double check the shot here. Yeah, okay, you can see that. So the light source here, it sends light out like so, and then it hits this reflecting surface and it reflects back in, and then it projects that reflection on a reticle inside. So if there's any difference, you know, if this is not perfectly square with the world in there, okay, that return image has a separation, okay, and that reads as an angle change, okay. So we calibrate at zero and then we move, and then if there's any tilt to this item at all, you can actually measure that angle very, very precisely, okay? And from that, through basic trig, you can determine differences in height, okay? So we can actually measure the straightness along this optical axis here, okay? And so let's move this back into frame here. So here's the business end of this, okay? And you look through this and you make adjustments here to bring the image and center the image in the reticle, okay? Or the return image, I should say. So if you started, let's see, where's zero? There's zero. So if you start at zero and you move a little bit to bring the image back, you read the difference in the two readings, okay? And then each one of these lines, one line is, there it is, one division is 2/10 of an arc second, okay? That is a pretty small number, okay? Now, to put that in perspective, an arc second at 100 yards is about a 64th of an inch. So 15 thousandths at 100 yards, that's one arc second. So this thing will discriminate 2/10 of that, okay? 2/10 of 15 thousandths, okay? 3/1000 at 100 yards, okay? That's pretty small stuff. Now, so it's kind of neat. So you can check straightness and squareness and some other things with it. You do need a mirror, which I don't have right now. And so I'm shopping for a mirror. So ideally a Hilger Watts mirror. But anyway, I'm looking for a mirror so I can start playing around with this and showing it on the channel. So anyway, new addition to the metrology gear, Hilger Watts autocollimator. All right, so this was sent to me by Logic Industries, and actually Adam Booth got one of these too, and he did a review on his already. But I was gonna, I didn't get to this until now, and I'm gonna give my commentary on it. So you know, the standard deal is, you know, people contact me regularly with, hey, could you review this tool? Could you show this on your channel, et cetera, et cetera. And some things I just kind of reject out of hand because they don't kind of meet with the channel content, right? And you know, I'm not going to review car parts on here, for example, things like that. But this is aligned nicely with what we do here on the channel. So you know, I agreed to this, and I said, listen, I said, here's the conditions. Is I'll give it an honest review, right? If I don't like it, I'm going to say so, okay? And if I do like it, I'll tell you the things that I do like. So that's the deal, okay? And that's how it works. So anyway, and you know what? I can't remember this guy's name. It's been a while. And he sent me a nice letter. He sent me a nice letter, and he signed the letter, and I can't read his name. So he's going to remain anonymous. But here's the some of the links, and there's a link in the description too if you want to buy one. But basically, what it is it's a heavy duty tap center, right? Okay, and it's 6 inches long, 150 millimeters, and which is great, and it's got a nice stiff spring in it, which works wonderfully. So, the things to watch out for on these is any wiggle between the moving part and the housing, and this one feels tight, at least right now. And now, so here's the negative things that, from Tom's opinion, okay? One is, who makes this, right? I'm rolling it all the way around. There's no name on it, okay? So guys, you need to put your name on your stuff if you're proud of it, okay? So they sent me all kinds of stickers to go where? On here? No, that's not going to go on there. You need to mark your tools, okay? If you're proud of what you're making, put your mark on it, okay? And put the information on how to get more of them or get parts or get it repaired or whatever. Put it right on the tool so it can't get separated, okay? I do like the spring pressure on this one, and I do like the length of it, which is kind of nice. Now, we're going to go over on the mill, and we'll check this out on the mill, and we'll talk about it a little bit more. So, all right, so here's the tap guide set up in the mill, and it feels great. It's got a nice, good spring on it, and quite a bit of travel, which is actually really important, too.
So that part feels wonderful. So, and it works for nice big ones. Now, okay, so big ones really, it isn't an issue because there's quite a bit of area around it. But you can see this is a half 13 here, and it's got a kind of a reduced shank on it, but I still want to use my nice tap driver on it, right? So if we put a tap wrench on this, okay, so you can see here, because the point is so large, it's actually touching the tap wrench, okay? Now, you know, I could go find another tap that has a bigger square on it, okay, or get a smaller tap wrench, but that isn't the idea. So as you can see, the centers are not particularly large, right? Even in a pretty good sized tap, right? So a suggestion, gentlemen, from Logic, is that you reduce the nose a little bit so that we don't drag on the tap wrench, okay? And there's another reason why that's going to be important, is I checked this with a file, and it's not hard. So to me, this is one of the major flaws with this tool, is this isn't hard, okay? It's quite soft, actually. So in reality, if we preload that and we start going to town on it, all right, it's already cutting into the side of that, okay? So one way to fix that is fine, just drill into that, okay? And press fit a quarter inch or 5/16 dowel pin that has your center on it, okay, which is more than large enough for even a large tap, but it will clear a smaller tap wrench and be hard on top of it. So but you would have to probably grind those 60 degree angles on there, okay? So, you know, I'm not being a dork here. I'm just, like I said, I just call it like I see it, okay? And I would call this constructive feedback, is get to a hard tip, and my suggestion would be to reduce that diameter, because the rest of this is wonderful, okay? It's got good travel, nice heavy spring, and it's well made. Don't know what they sell these for. This was complimentary, and maybe they're, at this point, sorry they sent me one. So anyway, gentlemen at Logic, you got a nice product. A couple more tweaks and you'll be looking good.